Caroline Hyde. This is Bloomberg Technology. Coming up, the fallout continues in Google's ad controversy. Are changes at YouTube enough to keep competitors from chipping away at its massive digital ad sales? Plus, 23andMe clears a major regulatory hurdle. Our exclusive interview with CEO Anna Wojcicki on the future of the genetic testing market. And Samsung investors shrug off scandals to report higher than expected prelim earnings. Could the South Korean giant be bouncing back? First to our lead. Google continues to fight back from its ad controversy. YouTube will now require video channels on its site to reach 10,000 total views before pairing videos with advertisers, raising the bar for those posting on the site. But is it enough after advertisers have found their ads running next to offensive and extremist content? Or are competitors already jumping in to grab a larger share of the massive digital advertising market from Google? Joining us with more is Jitendra Warrell, his senior research analyst at Bloomberg Intelligence, and Bob O'Donnell, president of Technalysis, who is our guest host for the hour. Gentlemen, great way to be kicking off this show, because Google's pain, Jitendra, potentially someone else's gain. I really want to get an idea of who potentially could be eating away at what is a dominant force that Google has. You've run a lot of analysis on this.
Well, first of all, it's important to understand this measurement problem, this classification problem of user-generated content, which is continuously evolving. It doesn't have a one-time fix. You know, this is an evolving problem which will have an evolving platform. And it's not just related to YouTube or Google, for that matter. It's an industry-wide issue. It started with the YouTube, and obviously we had some escalation leading up to the event. We had the fake news concerns. We had Facebook reporting their metrics correctly and things like that. So this measurement issue in general, it's basically making advertisers sort of think again as to like, okay, do we need an intermediary here to look at the metrics that you know these companies are self-vetting? How do we make sure the ROI that we think we are getting is the one we are getting, and things like that? So they're pausing, and what I feel is like it's a near-term issue, but it's not a one-time fix, really. This is an evolving problem. As the content evolves, these solutions will have to evolve.
But who wins?
Who wins?
Does Amazon get a little bit of market share? They've only got, what, according to your analysis, 1.8% of the digital ad market here in the US. Could it get any more?
So categorically, TV for the near term, you know, because they can show the ROIs there. You have publishers, content publishers that have more control over their content. You have measurement companies, you know, the intermediaries that will work with likes of Google and Facebook to sort of vet their metrics. And of course, you have Amazon and retail and the other folks who are, you know, very slowly sort of growing the ad business, you know. And in fact, if you look at projections for Amazon next or this year, it's going to be $1.8 billion business for them. And the retail market is pretty big for advertising. So it's essentially the battle is here is like who can provide better ROI, who can provide better measurement, and who can provide more transparency. If they can longer term, you know, they have a business that they can longer term target.
And it's something that Sir Martin Sorrell, WPP, has been calling for years. And Bob, I want to get your sense on the rest of the industry. I mean, this is something clearly that YouTube and Google have to tackle forefront. But is this going to cause bigger, wider changes even than the changes we're seeing thus far?
I'm sure eventually it will. I mean, I do think this is an important first step, because by getting to the 10,000 level, for example, specifically on YouTube, you're at least, you know, kind of raising yourself above the noise. At the same time, what's interesting, if we think about who has some opportunities moving forward, you know, in a world where we have all kinds of very specific information, theoretically, there's an opportunity for a bunch of smaller players who are well targeted at particular audiences to do reasonably well. So I think that could be an interesting development. But, you know, the click issue, let's be honest, that's been around for arguably decades, since the web began, of how do you really count clicks? It almost kind of falls back to that same old problem.
Right.
Here we are again, trying to debate that. And I do think intermediaries do play a role, and I think there's going to have to become, at least, if not going to be standardization, a couple of well-known standards. As we've had Nielsen with TV, we'll see some of these other kinds of developments, you know, on the web that we can say are, okay, that's a reasonable metric of volume. But, you know, there's going to have to be a lot of work done. Luckily, AI can hopefully be used to be smarter about what things can be served, even if the numbers are above where theoretically they should be.
So machine learning could race to the rescue to a certain extent. Jitendra, as you said, this is such a broad problem that this is just one element of, really, that this fight back against YouTube and the changes they're making. We've heard of the fake news element, the pressure across the board. Fact-checking is also something that Google's just announced today, saying for Google Search, Google News, that they're going to be able to hopefully fact-check and ensure that some of the rogue answers don't come up anymore. Are we really going to see a clean-up of some of these darker corners of the web?
Well, we are seeing a lot of movement, and like I said, this movement is evolutionary. It's not going to be revolutionary. But what's interesting is, you know, to your point, Bob, this is a blessing in disguise for digital video advertising, because video advertising has not moved away from TV as quickly as anticipated as compared to some other platforms. And one of the bigger problems was this: brand safety, measurement, classification, things like that. If they come up with a standard solution with machine learning, with media rating council audits, or whatever intermediaries they involve, if there's a standard set, then the code is cracked on video advertising. Once the code is cracked, then you enter hypergrowth longer term. So this is a blessing in disguise, if you think about it, longer term,
for
video, digital video in general. But near term, you know, these steps will continue to evolve, I think.
And, you know, Carolyn, to your question on the fact-checking, I mean, I think it's going to be important. You know, it looks like in the descriptions that I read of what they're doing, it's still possible that somebody could game the system. They could claim to be a fact-checking site, and, you know, and then whether or not they were really a valid fact-checking site is yet another question. So these things get pushed, you know, further and further out in terms of who you can trust. But fundamentally, I think it's a good step forward to try and see, okay, how can we evolve this? People are no longer simply going to be able to blatantly rely on what it is that they've seen, and, you know, there'll be a little more checks and balances in place.
Great conversation to start off this particular show. Jitendra Warrell, Bloomberg Intelligence. Thanks. Great to have you on the show as ever. Bob O'Donnell, president of Technalysis, you're going to be sticking with me. Now, a story we are watching. TaskRabbit is said to be exploring a sale after it's received interest from potential buyers. Now, that's according to a report from Recode. The company has raised $38 million from VC firms like Lightspeed Ventures and Founders Fund. TaskRabbit is one of the best-known startups in the so-called gig economy that links freelance workers with jobs. Now, coming up, an exclusive conversation with one of the most well-known genetic testing startups, 23andMe's CEO Anne Wojcicki, on the company's big win from the FDA. That's next, and this is Bloomberg. Now, the Federal Communications Commission chief, Ajit Pai, may present a proposal to gut Obama-era net neutrality rules as soon as this month. This, according to a person familiar with the issue. Now, Pai has said he wants to maintain the basic principles of net neutrality laws, which legally prevent internet providers from blocking or prioritizing certain content within their networks for financial gain. Pai previously voted against the 2015 net neutrality order, saying that the laws were, quote, trying to solve a problem that didn't exist. Meanwhile, the DNA testing company, 23andMe, has cleared a major hurdle with the US regulators. The Food and Drug Administration has given the company the green light to sell genetic testing kits directly to consumers. It's the first and only company in the US to be cleared to provide such reports without prescription. In a turnaround for the FDA, which previously imposed a moratorium on these types of home testing kits, while UK and Canada embraced it. Earlier, I spoke with 23andMe CEO Anne Wojcicki in an exclusive interview. I started by asking about the requirements the company had to meet to earn this approval.
The FDA wanted us to prove 2 points. So one, to make sure that the data is accurate, so that if I tell you a certain result, that we know that the quality, that result is reproducible, that actually is in fact that result. The second thing that we really had to go and prove is the comprehension, and go around the country, prove that all different education levels could understand this data. And I think it's one of the things that's core to 23andMe is we really have this belief that anyone could be a scientist, anyone can learn about themselves, and that science is in within the reach of anyone. And so we designed the product and the experience specifically so that anyone of any education level can understand this information.
And it's 10 conditions that have been granted thus far, including Alzheimer's, Parkinson's. How did you select these particular conditions to run with first, and will you be adding to them?
We will definitely be adding to them, and that's part of the whole process and the experience of 23andMe is that we want to keep consumers up to date as more genetic discoveries are happening. We focused originally on Parkinson's and Alzheimer's because those are two of the most commonly requested reports that our customers want. And I think one thing that people don't fully realize is that the medical system doesn't have those because you could, you know, talk about whether or not you can do anything. Is there a clinical intervention with Alzheimer's? But what we found is that consumers actually really want this information because they might be making a lifestyle change. They want to be empowered with this information.
And they've been seeking information for other things prior to this. Not since 2013 they've been able to find out ancestry history. In fact, perhaps certain caffeinated beverages they might react to in a certain different way. Mm-hmm. And also, notably, what their children might be inheriting. Mm-hmm. If you've already done a 23andMe test, can you automatically find out what your reliability is in terms of the 10 conditions you're now adding?
Yeah, so if for customers who are on an existing FDA-cleared platform, so that means if they've gotten in the last few years, they will get these reports. For customers who are on a pre-existing platform, they might have actually had the old experience or will enable in some capacity some way for them to upgrade to it. But for people, for instance, who bought a year ago, they will get these reports.
And you're giving education, you're making everyone a scientist, as you say, but what then how empowered are they to use that information? Are we expecting people to run off to their doctors because they have certain significant more exposure to these sort of genetic conditions? Or can they embrace it, use it, go to their insurers and show that actually they're far perhaps safer than many had anticipated?
I think one thing that people don't fully understand, there's a lot of aspects of healthcare, especially in the prevention world, that don't necessarily tap into what we see as the traditional healthcare system. So more what we find is that people find out that they're at risk for something and they want to make lifestyle changes. So they might want to start exercising more, they might want to change their diet, they want to almost have sort of a coach of sorts. So what we found, and we actually did these studies in the UK, where we found that people aren't running to their physicians to ask more questions, that some of them actually do bring it up on their next scheduled physician appointment, but it's not necessarily generating more visits for physicians. But people do want to make lifestyle changes, and I think that's where there is a real opportunity. You know, when I think big picture about 23andMe, we want to embrace a consumer healthcare movement where consumers are actually thinking about their healthcare not, you know, episodically when they go to the doctor, but they're thinking about every day. What am I eating? Am I exercising? What am I doing? What are the choices I'm making? And I think that's where more and more, as we think about the retail world and your daily experience and other online consumer-focused companies, those groups are going to help people make some of the behavior changes that we know customers actually want to make.
They want the coaching. Is 23andMe going to be providing the coaching as well?
I don't think we're not providing it. We provide links to individuals. I think what we see, our expertise is genetics and making it really clear for individuals the information and the risks that they have. We want to partner and we want to enable all kinds of other companies then to help customers take it to the next level and to execute in that way.
And what about also the reach of your own business and where you take it next? Because you've in fact been using the data, and this is a key question, what the privacy angle is of all of 23andMe. That's something that always comes springing to mind for many of the users. Can you confirm how the data is used and actually what the data might do to help push forward research into certain diseases?
Right, so data privacy has always been first to us. We've always defined privacy based on customer choice. So if you want to share your data with no one, you share it with no one. 23andMe will never share individual level data without customers' explicit consent. So privacy is a huge priority for us. That said, what we have found, people with a specific disease often want us to do research and to partner to do research with other companies. So it's a matter of choice. People have the ability to opt into that. We have a consent form, and over 80% of our customers, 85% of our customers are actually opting into that research. And we want to, you know, the mission of the company is help people access, understand, and benefit from the human genome. And the way we're all going to benefit is with a big data set of genetic information and information about those customers. And so we have over 2 million individuals today. We have probably the largest genetic phenotypic database in the world where we can make discoveries. And I think anyone who's ever been to the doctor has suffered from the experience of not necessarily knowing what is the best path forward. So if you have a disease, we may or may not know exactly what you should do. And that's one of the things that 23andMe is hoping to solve, is with all this information, help individuals really have personalized health care and personalized treatments.
That was 23andMe CEO Anne Wojcicki. Coming up, Samsung investors shrug off scandals over safety and corruption claims to report higher than expected preliminary earnings. We'll bring you the details next. And a feature we'd like to bring to your attention is our interactive TV function. You can find it at TV Go on the Bloomberg. You'll not only be able to watch us live, but also see previous interviews and dive into any of the securities or Bloomberg functions we talk about. And you can become part of the conversation by sending us instant messages during our shows. This is for Bloomberg subscribers only, though, I'm afraid. Check it out at TV Go. This is Bloomberg. Now, despite a handful of serious scandals, Samsung has posted its best operating profit in almost 4 years. Now, that's thanks to strong sales of memory chips and display screens. Samsung is still trying to bounce back from last year's Galaxy Note 7 crisis and is counting on its new flagship S8 model to restore its reputation after the exploding battery debacle. Meantime, the company's de facto leader, J.Y. Lee, made his first appearance in court Friday in a massive corruption trial. Joining us now from Washington is Troy Stangerone. He's Korea Economic Institute Senior Director. Also with us, guest host of the hour, Bob O'Donnell, President of Technalysis Research. And Troy, to bring you in first of all, I mean, these numbers, they've surprised me. If you really were an alien looking at these numbers for the first time, you would not have anticipated perhaps the best profit, quarterly profit, in more than 3 years. What is really driving the resilience from your point of view? And are you surprised just how much they've weathered the storm?
Well, I think this is being driven largely by the chip business. What we're expecting to see is that profits on the smartphones are going to be down maybe as much as 50%. But if you look at the DRAM specifically, there's been a significant boost both in demand for DRAM and in the price of DRAM. And I think Samsung is really positioned well to take advantage of that.
And Bob O'Donnell, I need to get your point of view here, because what blows my mind is when you go onto the Bloomberg terminal, you type in, say, something like analyst recommendations, you can see that 41 are buys, there's only one sell on this, and the price target remains resolutely higher than the current share price. From your point of view, can they sustain this sort of bullishness?
Well, I think they can for a while. I mean, it is important to remember that Samsung is made up of a lot of different pieces, and the component piece that provides the displays, the DRAM, and the other and SSDs and other kinds of components is very robust and built not just by what Samsung does, but by what Apple does and what all their other competitors do, because they sell parts to all those players.
Frenemies.
Exactly. Now, on top of that, the S8, I was at their launch event in New York, and it is an impressive new device. And I think it's going to do quite well. And barring any other major disasters, which I think they've pretty well protected themselves against with all the testing they're doing, I think it'll do quite well. And so that's going to give them some more momentum yet again. And they continue to branch out. We see this smart hub device that they offered at that event as well. So moving more into the smart home space. I mean, they're building themselves a very strong, interesting platform play, even though they don't have an OS. Well, they have Tizen, but let's be honest, that doesn't really
count.
Not
quite as good as Android.
Yeah, exactly. But there's building these platforms and services out with Samsung Pay. They have an identity service. They have these other things that they're slowly but surely starting to build up that I think is going to make them a competitive threat long term.
I mean, already, what is it, was number one mobile player in the world. See whether they steal that back. I just want to bring to you, Troy, an envision for you. The reliance, I know you know it, but I want to show our viewers on our Bloomberg on my screen. I've currently just got how important Samsung is to South Korea in terms of the economy. 19% of total South Korean market cap is this one standalone juggernaut that is Samsung. And I want to get on to the other debacle that we mentioned, and that being, of course, the political scandal that is engulfing the company. J.Y. Lee, the de facto leader in court today, it was Friday. What are you seeing? What is South Korea seeing, and what are the steps that we should look out for as to whether he could really be prosecuted for this and what it meant for the company?
Well, I think, as we expected, E.J. Young came in today and he said that he was not guilty of the charges presented before him. This has been Samsung's case the whole time going forward, that they were in essence extorted by Chae-Soon Chil and by extension Park Geun-hye, but that they did not take and seek a bribe to take and push forward the earlier merger between Chul Industries and Samsung ST. But going forward, I think there's, you know, essentially three things we need to look at. You know, this is taking place in a very sort of unique political environment. One factor, I think, going forward is going to be the trial of Chae-Soon Chil, which has already started. If she perhaps is found not guilty, that would have significant impact potentially on E.J. Young's case. If she's convicted, it could have repercussions for his case, but it might not, depending on what she's convicted for.
Remind us why she's important, quickly.
She is the one who is essentially the go-between, it's claimed, between President Park Geun-hye, Samsung, and the other chaebols. So she is the one who took and did, essentially, the requests for the bribes, if you will, if this is proven. And so I think beyond her, we also need to look, President Park Geun-hye may get charged here in the near future. What those charges are may also give indications. But I think we also need to look at the ongoing presidential race. The whole question of pardons has come up in the election, and depending on who wins, it might have an impact on E.J. Young's future, depending on if he is convicted.
And lastly, Bob, when you're looking at Samsung, do you look at it as a part-by-part company of this conglomerate? Do you worry about the political corruption scandal engulfing it? Does it not affect the company? Because none of the analysts seem to be caring.
Yeah, no, I mean, you do look at all the components, and I think that there's plenty of opportunity. My bigger fear, to be honest with you, is what happens with North Korea. That is the bigger factor because of the influence it would have on South Korea and Samsung in particular.
Fascinating. Just to add that political element to the equation as well. As ever, Bob O'Donnell, brilliant you're sticking with me for the hour. And Troy Stangaroan, wonderful to have you joining us as ever from Korea Economic Institute, Senior Director, live from Washington with us. Now coming up, the court saga, another one, well this time between Alphabet's Waymo and Uber, rages on as both sides step up their arguments. We'll discuss next. This is Bloomberg. This is Bloomberg Technology. I'm Caroline Hyde. Now, the H-1B visa application program officially opened this week with new measures from the US government to make the highly competitive program even tougher for applicants. Earlier, we spoke to Bloomberg Technology's Eric Newcomer and Tom Giles about the impact of these changes on giants like Google, along with other headline-grabbing over the times of this week. Have a listen.
This set of rules that started trickling out on Friday afternoon is really aimed at the lower end, the outsources of the world. They bring in these Indian-based firms, bring in workers, and then they send them back overseas. Google stands to benefit.
This is why we saw a slight share drop in the likes of Tata Consultancy, the
Wipro,
Infosys,
yep.
Those based in India. Eric, what about the startup community as well, though? Because how much do they depend upon H-1B visas to bring in the right sort of tech talent they need from, number one, India, but China, UK, France even use these visas to be able to bring people based from those countries into the U.S.
Right. I mean, certainly there's a culture of lots of immigrant founders here. Many of the top tech companies today were founded by immigrants, and they hire a lot of people from outside the United States. So it's certainly an important program to them. I just think, you know, a lot of people saw this sort of coming. It doesn't have quite the same moral force. People understand it a little bit more, yeah. Even if they depend on the workers. And so I think we just haven't seen the same backlash as sort of the immigration bans.
Many feel this needs to be tweaked, maybe some hoops to jump. Tom, I'm going to move on to the next interesting story that hit us on Monday, and it was perhaps a leak of what Verizon was going to be naming AOL and the combination of the internet assets of Yahoo. It came out on Monday, and it was had a rather painful experience on Twitter. It's going to be called Oath, not the first thing that springs to mind, of course, that you might name a company that has experienced a particular amount of, well, I mean, of course, of the fact hacking experienced
right.
by Yahoo. I want to first of all bring in Tim Armstrong, because we did actually speak to the CEO of AOL, and he tried to see the brighter side. Have a listen.
It actually clears the lane for us to really promote Yahoo and AOL and TechCrunch and Huffington Post and Movie Phone. So it's really a values-based brand. It's long-term. You know, some of the reaction you see to the brand, I think, is very short-term thinking, and we're a long-term company.
Tom, he said, actually, in fact, Tim Armstrong in that interview said $50 million worth of marketing was able to be garnered by this particular leak. But still, there was a little bit of chuckling.
They took a lot of heat on the Twitters over this one. My favorite was Oof, right?
By TechCrunch, no less, yeah. Which they own.
Which right. they own, right? They've got integrity. Here's my thinking on it. It's not a bad name. I don't see the problem with it. It's an umbrella name for them organizationally, sell ads for all of these different properties. As far as we can tell so far, the property names, the individual brands, don't go away. These are companies that have a lot of brand recognition. TechCrunch, Yahoo, even though it might be a slightly aging population, there are still a billion people who use this, who come to the Yahoo sites.
Who had so their data massively
think,
breached.
Exactly, although the question is how many people have left Yahoo as a result of that. People are still tied to their email providers. So my question is, you know, does this really hurt them? Oath, I don't see it as a bad thing.
I think if Tronc is our benchmark, Oath is pretty okay. You know, I think it's palatable. I also think, you know, if this were a hipper company, they'd probably get more credit for it. You know, I mean, that's just sort of the fact. It's sort of an old guard company, so Oath.
Poor Tim Armstrong.
They get a hard.
You could have done a lot worse. Mondelez, come on. Verizon itself is a made up name. Remember back 15 years ago, right? Bell Atlantic GTE. It's not its own name. It's not a real thing. It's made up. And they've done very well with that brand.
The joy of rebranding. It's always a tricky path for many a company. Talking of tricky paths for many a company, let us dig into, once again, another bit of an Uber scandal. Eric, it is your company. You are all over it. Yeah. And it's the Waymo, which is the self-driving car unit of Alphabet, of Google.
Right. So Uber finally filed their response, sort of defended themselves a little. They're basically arguing, we're not using Waymo's technology. So whatever happened with those 14,000 files, that's not what our LiDAR, the little lasers we use to understand where everything is in the world when we're driving around, we're not using Waymo's technology, so we're fine. You know, we shouldn't get what's called a preliminary injunction against us. So basically right now they're fighting over whether the court will sort of snap its fingers and say, Uber, you need to stop operating right away because it looks really, really bad for you.
That was Bloomberg News Executive Editor of Technology, Tom Giles, and Bloomberg Technology Startups Reporter, Eric Newcomer. Now, another big court case this week. Twitter withdraws its lawsuit against the U.S. government just one day after filing it. The suit was intended to block a summons to identify anonymous Twitter users who had been critical of President Trump. Joining us now is Bloomberg Technology's Sarah Fryer, who covers the company, and, of course, our guest host for the hour, Bob O'Donnell from Technalysis. Sarah, I mean, great reporting throughout. And is it possible to call this a victory of sorts for Twitter?
This is absolutely a victory for Twitter. When I first saw the headline, I thought, oh my God, they already withdrew their suit, but they withdrew it because the government stopped asking for that information, which means they scared the government away in this sense, and the government knew that they did not have a case to really get this from Twitter.
However, talk to us about some of the background to all of this, because Twitter this time was taking the government head on, quite fascinating considering how much Donald Trump has helped drive the agenda of Twitter in many ways. But sometimes they cooperate.
So Twitter will cooperate in these instances when there's actually a criminal case. Like there was a case a couple weeks ago or a few weeks ago where a user sent an epilepsy-inducing tweet to a journalist, and he actually had a seizure, and it was very dangerous. Twitter gave the government information about that user and that he was arrested. So in those cases, Twitter will help, and they actually provide a transparency report on their website of all the government requests they've gotten around the world and all the times they've actually acted on them. When it comes to free speech matters, though, which is what they considered this case, they are steadfast about not giving information to the government. And in fact, Twitter's actually been shut down in countries at times when they've refused to give information, and they're not afraid to go to court.
Bob, it's rather fascinating what it shows that Twitter will do, but also it shows the concerns of Donald Trump and how much they want to shut down any criticism.
Indeed, it does. You know, and it does reflect absolutely that this is not a criminal case, right? And so it's a great win for Twitter. Frankly, the first win, let's be honest, they've had in a while in almost anything. So it's good news for them, and it shows that they're willing to stand up to a certain level of what should be acceptable. And I think that's great, and I think they need to do that. That reflects an independence that they need to maintain if they're going to maintain, their view of being this platform where a lot of discussion can occur. Because if they didn't, and given how much, Trump has been using Twitter, I think that would reflect rather poorly on them. So I think this was very critical for them to turn this one around.
Big win, but shares still down 0.7%. What can you do? Great to have you on, Sarah Fryer, as ever. Wonderful reporting on everything across Twitter. And Bob O'Donnell, president of Technalysis Research, going to be sticking with me. Now, one stock we're also watching for you, Okta, making its public debut Friday. Shares of the enterprise software company popped 39% and has a market cap of just over $2 billion now. Okta is backed by Andreessen Horowitz, Greylock Partners, Coastal Ventures and Sequoia Capital. Now, coming up, Spotify may have an answer for a public market exit that sidesteps the frenzy of such as Okta and, of course, the Snap IPO alike. We'll hear from an investor in the company next. This is Bloomberg. Now on the latest tech funding board, the struggling music streaming company Pandora has asked the major record labels for money or better deal terms to help reverse its losses. This according to people familiar with the matter who say that the music labels are unlikely to heed these requests. Pandora still generates significant cash from its online radio service, but it's under pressure from activist investor Corvex Management to prove its better days are still ahead as an independent company. Shares slid in Friday trading and remain below the company's 2011 IPO price of $16. Meantime, its rival Spotify made waves this week on reports that it's considering an unusual way to satisfy investors. Spotify is said to be weighing a direct listing rather than a traditional IPO. The process would not involve underwriters and would sidestep much of the price speculation that traditionally precedes the public debut of a tech unicorn, like we saw, of course, with Snap last month. Joining us now to discuss is one of Spotify's backers, Nimay Mehta, partner at Lead Edge Capital. Also still with us is our guest host, Bob O'Donnell of Technalysis Research. We'll be asking a few questions of you, Nimay. But first of all, direct market listings, circumventing IPO, they don't need to raise any more cash in so doing, but would this be a positive step?
Hi, Caroline. Hi, Bob. Good to be with you. Our view on the direct listing is actually quite positive. We think it signals confidence by management. You know, first and foremost, it reflects this idea that the business is financially sound. They have enough cash on their balance sheet to fund their growth and support the business. And they don't need to go and raise billions of dollars in an IPO to be sustainable and successful. So that's the first thing. And the second thing, it does challenge this notion that a business needs to go through the traditional IPO roadshow and process in order to market the story. But our view is that great companies, great businesses, don't need the IPO roadshow necessarily to have a following from the investment community. We very much believe in management's capacity to do the right thing for the business, the right thing for shareholders, and are not convinced that the IPO roadshow is the de facto route for companies to go public.
There, of course, has been debt taken on by Spotify, and it confuses me as to perhaps why they wouldn't want to take on more money just to pay down that debt. And indeed, the onerous the terms of the debt in some ways are pushing them to go for an IPO or indeed a direct sales share listing sooner rather than later. Are you applying as an investor? Would you like to see this come in 2017 rather than delay to 2018?
Look, we'd love for the business to go public. Obviously, management needs to determine the right time for an offering. Our view is that the trigger for the IPO is not the debt piece. The terms, are not driving the decision to go public, but rather, you know, the appropriate market conditions and the appropriate timing for the company. You know, just this past week, they did solidify their negotiations with Universal. We feel like that was a huge milestone in the company's path to going public. And so those are the big milestone drivers for the business rather than, you know, a financial instrument that we believe the company can more than support.
So Nimay, my question is, does this reflect a changing atmosphere around tech IPOs in general, right? You could argue that with what we saw with Snap and now with Spotify here, is there this sense that tech companies are trying to take more control to themselves away from Wall Street? And so what does that mean for Wall Street and what does that mean for investors?
Look, it's no surprise to us, as innovative as Spotify is, they're taking an innovative approach here as they think about this IPO and contemplate a potential direct listing. Our view is that historically, IPO roadshows led by the investment banking community, stocks can be underpriced. And in the Snapchat example, the stock went up 40% the day after it was listed. So in this case, we let the market determine what the price of the stock should be. And sure, it may come at the expense of some investment banking fees, but it's better for all shareholders, it's better for the company, and we believe that it's a viable route for companies in general. Our view is if Spotify can successfully execute a transaction like this, they can generate investor following on the equity research side and have liquidity in their stock, this could become a template for companies in the future to go public and do a direct listing versus go through the traditional IPO route.
I'm thinking of another very well-capitalized company that you invest in and that is also reticent to go for an IPO anytime soon, and that might be Uber. Would they follow a similar route, do you think? Would you want to see them starting to go public sooner rather than later if this was an option?
Our view is that, our view on Uber specifically is that, look, the company is doing tremendously well as a private business. They have a lot of flexibility as a private company to execute and strategize the way they would like to. We're no strangers to being patient about waiting for an IPO. At LeadEdge, you know, our largest investment historically was in a company called the Alibaba Group. And Alibaba took 15 years to go public, and it was very much worth the wait. In the case of Uber specifically, the competitive landscape, the regulatory environment, there are a lot of things in flux. The business is only 8 years old and still very early in its broader development as a company. And so we're behind management, you know, in this being the right time to stay private as a company. And at some point in the future, an IPO is likely in the cards for a company of this scale, this size. It doesn't seem like there are any other paths for liquidity for shareholders. But our sense is that it's not going to happen anytime soon, and we're very supportive of that.
Just worth the wait, LeadEdge Capital partner Nimay Mehta. It's been wonderful having you joining us on the show. Thank you very much indeed for your time, live from New York. And of course, my great thanks to, as ever, our guest host of the hour, Bob O'Donnell, president of Technalysis Research. Great to have you with us, as ever. Hope to see you soon. Now coming up, Amazon disrupted e-commerce for the consumer, but now it's targeting business and enterprise customers. What can industrial suppliers do to stay ahead of the Goliath that's next? And this is Bloomberg. Now, Amazon Business, that's the company's business-to-business supply arm, is set to disrupt the industrial supply chain sector. It collected more than $1 billion in revenue and grew by 20% month over month. Now, that's according to data from Applico. So, how exactly is Amazon taking aim on this highly fragmented market? And is this a new area of disruption, really? Joining us from New York is Alec Moazed, CEO of Applico. Wonderful to have you with us, Alex. And perhaps not a new threat. Perhaps this is something that's been going on potentially by being threatened by Amazon for some 20 years. Where would Amazon, though, really want to make inroads in the B2B space? Which sectors in particular?
So there were court documents released last fall without them really being a fan of them being released. And they were citing the industrial supply industry, which includes things called MRO, maintenance, repair, and operational products. Those are distributed by companies like Grainger or MSC Direct, which just released their quarterly earnings yesterday morning.
Fascinating that you bring up MSC Direct and indeed Grainger. We were speaking with our colleagues in Bloomberg Intelligence and they were digging into some of these theories, and they're feeling that actually MSC Direct is really a very value-added element, I mean, in particularly the metalworking products. Do you think Amazon has the discipline, the dedication to want to get into that value-added nature, to train up and to hire, to compete, not just on price, but certainly on the value-add, the services sector, whereas maybe they'd rather be in the Grainger part of the equation where it's more basic products that they could be muscling in on?
Yeah, Grainger is definitely more vulnerable than MSC, yet both companies still have a very large proportion of their revenue that comes from those MRO products that is doing industrial supply. MSC has about 60% of all of their products are sold online through their website, which is an e-commerce site. And where Amazon attacks you first are on what we call your pack and ship products. Those actually tend to have a good amount of margin. A lot of these companies are moving towards more value-add services, as you're talking about. However, Amazon can cause a lot of disruption to a distributor like MSC or Grainger's bottom line by just taking an attack at that pack and ship revenue, also what they call spot buys. For Grainger, that's about 40% of their revenue, and they plan on reducing prices between 15 to 25% on the online prices for their spot buy product segments, which is a pretty considerable impact.
So already the price pressure is being put on. Alex, of course, a company such as yours, like Applico, is rather hoping that the companies as these wake up, smell the coffee, might come to you for helping to build themselves their own marketplaces in reaction to Amazon. So your maybe a bit of disruption would help your particular business. But what is this generally a negative for a lot of consumers? Certainly they've loved the disruption that Amazon has brought. What could the economies of scale really bring to the economy at large if Amazon did get into B2B?
So in general, there's a huge opportunity for these distribution companies. Amazon is both a marketplace with third-party sellers, but they're also a reseller, which is the same thing as what these distribution companies are. They are resellers. What they need to start doing is embracing this third-party seller marketplace, which is what Amazon has been doing for almost 20 years now. And that business model is called the platform business model. The fun characteristic of that is that those business models have a winner-take-all dynamic, which means there's really only one or two companies that dominate an industry's market share. So in these industries, they're highly fragmented. The marketplace are valued much greater than the linear distribution business model. So the distributors could actually be in a position to drastically increase their market share if they were to look at revising their business model structure and embracing that marketplace model, letting third-party sellers sell alongside them on their website.
We'll see how quickly that disruption comes, or indeed how quickly these companies respond. Alex Moazed, CEO of Applico, wonderful to have you live with us. Thank you very much indeed. Now that does it for this edition of Bloomberg Technology. On Monday's show, we'll be speaking with MySpace co-founder Chris DeWolf about his latest venture in mobile gaming. This is Bloomberg.